In the United States, when one party prevails in litigation, it's not always clear that they will be enabled to recover their attorney's fees and costs from the non-prevailing party. This is known as the American rule. It's something that is not typically true with other court systems around the world, but it is part of our jurisprudence in the United States. And the exceptions are several. Two of them would be if there's a statute that says that the prevailing party is entitled to recover their attorney's fees, and another would be if there's a contract between the litigants which says that the party which prevails in a dispute is entitled to recover their attorney's fees and costs from the non-prevailing parties. And if you were to get together five lawyers and ask what their opinions are about the virtues of prevailing party clauses, you'd probably get 10 to 15 answers, because this is a very complicated topic. And I'll be the first to admit that there are times when I negotiate design and construction contracts where I will include a prevailing party clause, and there are other instances where I'll strike it out of the contract. But generally speaking, I tend to think that prevailing party clauses are dangerous. And I think that they're something which I typically don't like to see in design and construction contracts, because I am a big proponent of early, cost-efficient dispute resolution. And I tend to find that prevailing party clauses have a negative impact on the behavior of clients and their lawyers. So let me back up and explain. You know, like many professionals out there, architects and engineers and, you know, frankly, contractors too, lawyers need to stay busy. We need to have clients. And there's nothing that makes a lawyer more excited than when a potential client comes to them with a head of steam. Oh, I've been wronged. I've got a great claim. You know, typically that party's looking out of one side of their eye only, but they're enthused. And they go to the lawyer and they say, I want you to file a lawsuit on my behalf. And the lawyer that needs to stay busy, it's like Christmas morning. They're thinking, this is great. Yes, you were wronged. You know, they reinforce the client's sentiments. And then sometimes they say, and you know what? There's a prevailing party clause in your contract, which means that you're not going to have to pay my fees. We're going to get it from the other side. And, you know, it's this selective attention to facts which tends to blind various parties at the outset of a dispute to the weaknesses of their case. And so you'll have the lawyer file a lawsuit, and, you know, there'll be motion practice and pleadings and discovery, and 6 or 9 months go by, and there's all this money that the lawyer's collected, and the client is perhaps no closer to actually having the dispute resolved. And, you know, when I get involved defending these claims and I've got a self-righteous lawyer that's representing a self-righteous client that is firmly convinced that they can do nothing but win, not only do I need to slow the steaming ship, you know, that's, you know, the aircraft carrier that's steaming at 50 knots, I need to slow it and I need to turn it around, and I need to show not just the lawyer, but I need to show the client decision maker that, you know what, your claim's not so good as you thought it was. And it's something that I've got, you know, 18 years of litigation experience doing. The problem is that by the time that I am able to get through to the decision maker, to the owner of the other side, the one that is paying the money to fund the litigation against my client, by the time that I'm able to get them to realize that their case is not as clean as they thought, because they are guilty of that selective attention to facts that litigants tend to be guilty of at the outset of litigation, then we have the project of sunk costs. Now the owner of the other party is saying, well, you know, I've already dropped $250,000 pursuing this claim. So what I want in settlement is not just, you know, the underlying principal value of the claim, but I have to get my attorney's fees recovered as well. And this presents a very difficult situation, because there's no chance that I am going to advise my client, you know, 99 times out of 100 to pay the attorney's fees of the counterparty in addition to settling their claim. They may have, you know, embarked on this quixotic quest. They may have, you know, out of self-righteousness or something else, embarked on litigation that maybe they wouldn't have had they been possessed of all the facts and real perspective. And so you have this problem of parties not being able to get past the sunk costs of litigation, and it stands as an impediment to getting cases settled. All things being equal, and there are exceptions to every rule, would prefer to see parties file suit knowing that they're going to have to pay their own way, because it forces them to take a more honest and earnest look at the merits of the case and decide whether or not they want to charge ahead in litigation or whether they would be willing to engage in a dialogue, with me and my client to see whether there isn't perhaps another way of resolving the dispute, one that focuses on early, cost-efficient dispute resolution, one where the party's hard-earned business relationships can be salvaged. And I tend to find that many a misadventure is launched by, lawyers on behalf of self-righteous clients that believe they're not going to have to pay their way. And I think that there would be less strife and less protracted litigation and all the negative things that come with it if most parties are convinced at the outset of litigation that they are going to have to pay for their own attorney's fees and costs.